Well, good morning. We are glad to have you here with us this morning. Glad that you chose to be at First Methodist Church this morning. You might notice that we have our camp scene set up. Just wanted to change things up for you guys this week. Or we had VBS last week, one of the two. So you'll see this morning we're going to be celebrating VBS a little bit during our services and things like that. I want to take just a minute very quickly to share three or four quick announcements with you. First of those is, and you'll notice in your bulletin, but July 3rd we have a free concert here for celebrating our freedom. It's called Singing America Songs. So be here July 3rd at 7 p.m. That's a Tuesday night, but a great time, be a great time just of celebrating our freedom, our nation, the things that that we love so much. Secondly, down there at the bottom, you'll see on July the 11th, we have an ice cream social. Most of us like ice cream. Most of us kind of enjoy that stuff. So come and be a part of that on the 3rd, the 11th, at 7 p.m. On the back, you'll notice there's a thing there about the box fan drive. And so if you don't mind, if you have the opportunity to grab a box fan or two, bring those up to the church office. And we will collect those, and they'll be either picked up or we'll deliver them where they go. And as I mentioned, the church office, the last thing I want to remind you of is the church office will be closed tomorrow on Monday. We're all going to go home and sleep after a week of Vacation Bible School. So if you need us, there are a couple of, the email went out, and there's a couple of phone numbers on there, Ellen's phone number's on there. I think mine is on there. So if you need someone or something important, give us a holler, and if we see your number and we think that it's not important, I just ignore. Well, so there's some people that when they call, I just go, oh, okay. No, I'm kidding. We do have those numbers out there. If you need those, do call, but the office will be closed tomorrow. We'll be open for business on Tuesday. Let us take a moment, and I think we're going to do a little singing, so let's come on in. No, I am not singing. And as our kids are finding their way back, will you stand and join me in the call to worship this morning? We are called to be people of faith in the midst of the world. We gather here as people who live in the world, and yet God has called us together. God has called us to be part of a community.
God challenges us to consider questions of priority as we engage the world.
In this time together, may God open our hearts, minds, and eyes, allowing us to see deeper, helping us to live in the world while still offering a challenge to the ways of the world.
We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
We take a moment and pass the peace among each other today. Kiddos, it's time to come on up, but y'all just stay right down here on the floor, okay?
Check, one, two. Good morning. My name is Romper Webb, and I am the greatest otter expert this side of the Mississippi. And this is Otto, my pet otter. He goes with me everywhere I go, which always isn't the best thing, but I love him anyway. Maria, the owner of the Rolling River Rampage Adventure Center, asked me to come this week, help the campers learn more about the great outdoors and God as we discovered adventure on the river. On Monday, that's exactly what we did with the new campers. We introduced them to the camp staff, learned about Jesus, inviting the first disciples to join him and go on a new adventure with him. We also learned a new word, which I predict will be in the next edition of the Webster's Dictionary. Our whitewater rafting expert, Emma, likes to glitterfy things. Be it hats, Miss Maria's papers, be it the floor, be it the pews. If it has glitter on it, that would be Miss Maria, or Miss Emma, excuse me. We also learned the rapid ready verse. Boys and girls, all of you that were here, everybody,
pass through the waters,
I will be with you. Actually, Emma and I had a little disagreement one day, but we solved our differences and became very good friends. Had a wonderful week, and I can't wait to come back next year if they'll have us.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back, campers. My name is Maria Gardner, and I am the owner of Rolling River Rampage Adventure Center, where every experience is the ride of a lifetime with God. I've owned this peaceful place in the woods for over 10 years, and I've always loved the great outdoors, and so decided to retire here and purchase some property so that I could use it for God's glory, and that's exactly what we did this week. We learned on Tuesday that we all have our own special gifts and talents. In fact, I had a very special moment where I realized that Emma, who was all girly and pink and liked all that stuff, that she could still be a wonderful whitewater rafting leader. And the reason was because she had her own gifts and talents, and God loved her and everyone else exactly as she was. God gives each of us special talents and skills, and God accepts and loves Emma and everyone else just the way they are. We know that God bless the campers and all of you too with special gifts and abilities. And knowing that, this can help us accept and celebrate each other. And as a result, on Tuesday, we found acceptance on the river.
Greetings, my name is Emma Hurston, and I am the whitewater rafting expert on staff at Rolling River Adventure Center. I love working with children and teaching them about Jesus while having fun in the sun and on the water, which, by the way, is what we did with the campers all week. Most of them refer to me as Glitter Girl, and yes, I take that as a compliment. On Wednesday, my friend Romper and I had a mud fight, and we were not very nice to each other. We spent most of the evening fighting in front of the campers and lost our joy. The campers and Maria prayed for us during this time, and we all had a change of heart. In fact, I gave Romper my pink tutu, which is my favorite one, and he gave me his Olympic mudsliding medal, and we finally experienced some joy on the river.
Hi, everyone. My name is Buster Webb, and I am the identical twin brother of Romper Webb. If you ever have a hard time telling us apart, he always has otters, and I always have squirrels. So that's how you can tell us apart. Romper had to go on a special assignment Thursday, so he asked me to fill in with the campers. I have to say, it was the best time, wasn't it? Yeah. I got to tell jokes, and they loved them, right? Yeah. Oh, no. Well, I want to share one that they told me they loved that day. Where do otters keep their money? In a riverbank. Well, anyways, we got to relax most of the day. I even got in a water fight with Emma, even though she doesn't really think we're identical twin brothers. We were just lying around in the raft, and we took it easy most of the day. And Maria kind of got mad at us one time. But I reminded her that Jesus also took time to sit and relax and refresh his mind. In fact, our Bible story that Thursday was when Jesus had a special meal with his friends and he took some time to rest afterwards. So needless to say, on day 4 of the camp, we found rest.
Well, it's up to me to tell you about the last day of our camp. We had so much fun on the river. We got to make s'mores during our snack time, and they had a special s'mores bar. And we got to sing and dance, and we found a special water slide on the banks of the river. And the adventure leaders let the campers play on the slide all evening. We also had a special person that Romper knew that came in brought some animals from the woods, from the nearby woods, although we're not quite sure how some of them were found in the woods. Our Bible story was about a special promise that Jesus made to his disciples. He promised that he would always be with us. And everywhere which gives peace. So that's what we found on the river on Friday. We found peace on the river. Now, before we go, because I know you campers will be really disappointed if we don't do this, we're going to show everybody our rapid reminders and our rapid ready verse. So what I need you campers to do is turn and face all these wonderful people, and we're going to do the motions, okay?
Fine wing venture on the river. Fine acceptance on the river. Fine joy on the river. Fine rest on the river. Fine peace on the river.
And a rapid ready verse. When I pass
the waters, I will be with you.
As you can see, we had a wonderful week at camp with great campers. We had about 100 kids and around 60 volunteers. But we could not have done it without those volunteers, and they made it so very, very important. And we could not have BBS without each of you. So if you were a volunteer, please stand up and be recognized. I also wanted to tell you that this year we did the rice bowls again, and we collected over $700. And and there are some rice bowls out front on the VBS table if you would like to take some home and bring them back and contribute to that. We have about a month before we have to turn it in, so please feel free to donate to that cause if you would like.
I just want to say that we could not have done this without Sarah and all of the staff who really put in a lot of hard work and a lot of hours. So thank you.
Come up here.
guys need to. I'm sorry, I feel a little weird praying with all these squirrels, so give me a second. Church, will you pray with me? Dear God, I thank you so much for the laughter of the children in the halls. God, I thank you so much that our church was filled as people learning about God and giving us a chance to be your hands and feet. God, I want to thank you that I was given such a wonderful father. I want to thank you for being my heavenly father. God, I want to pray for those that maybe Father's Day isn't as joyful as it is for me. Maybe they didn't have a father that showed them your love. Perhaps this is the first Father's Day without their father. God, I want to take a moment to thank you for all those who make our lives a little bit easier. Those who serve us in forms of protection in the military, police officers, those who come in first responses when we need them, even for those who clean the bathrooms and cook our food. God, I pray that as my brothers and sisters speak things out loud, that you turn our ear, that you listen to our prayers as we say what's deeply in our hearts. God, thank you for listening. God, I pray over everything that was spoken out loud, that these become the prayers of our church and that you listen and you find yourself involved in whichever way you feel that you need to be. God, give peace where it needs peace. Give healing where it needs healing. Provide miracles if miracles are needed. We thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, let's end our time of prayer by saying the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day. As we forgive those who trespass against us, lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. Our hymn of preparation today is Near to the Heart of God, hymn 472, where the words will be on the screen.
down the ridicule and speak an allegory to the house of Israel. Say, thus says the Lord God, a great eagle with great wings and long pinions, rich in plumage of many colors, came to the Lebanon. He took the top of the cedar, broke off its topmost shoot. He carried it to a land of trade, set in a city of merchants. Then he took a seed from the land, placed it in fertile soil, a plant by abundant waters. He set it like a willow twig. It sprouted and became a vine spreading out, but lo, its branches turned toward him, its roots remained where it stood. So it became a vine. It brought forth branches, it brought forth foliage. There was another great eagle with great wings and much plumage. And see, this vine stretched out its roots toward him. It shot its branches toward him so that he might water it. From the bed where it was planted, it was transplanted to good soil by abundant waters so that it might produce branches and bear fruit and become a noble vine. Say, thus says the Lord of God, will it prosper? Will he not pull up its roots, cause its fruit to rot and wither, its fresh sprouting leaves to fade? No strong arm or mighty army will be needed to pull it from its roots. When it is transplanted, will it thrive? When the east wind strikes it, will it not utterly wither on the bed where it grew? The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you so much. It was a tough one. And our usual Bible, I was looking for it in early service, and it's holding up the forest behind me. Which is, you know, it's good to know that the Bible supports everything that we do in VBS. Amen. So, not only did I choose a scripture to preach on that's in the Old Testament, I chose an Old Testament parable. But I think we will get through this because I think I'm quite qualified to talk about withering plants. I recently moved to a new place here in Marble Falls a couple weeks ago, and my landlord was nice to give me the keys a little bit early, so the first thing I did was go and plant an herb garden. I love to have fresh basil and cilantro and all of those types of things. And this scripture became very personal to me if you just replace eagle with Great Dane. And instead of the vine growing or the herb growing towards the Great Dane, the Great Dane decides to just pull out your herbs like they're Kleenex from a box. And I can assure you it does not take much for the roots of a cilantro plant to burn and for the plant to wither. Now, before we get into the Bible story, I always like to talk a little bit about the Bible, especially when we spend time in the Old Testament. That's something that some of us don't always like to be, but it's where I always like to read. The Bible was not written by one person in one time in a certain place. It's really probably better characterized as a library of books. And it's written by kings, it's written by pastors, there's books in there by farmers. It's written in times of prosperity, and it's written in times of drought. It's written in times of peace and in times of war. And this is especially true in the Old Testament because it just takes a longer period. And we find ourselves reading the book of Ezekiel. Ezekiel comes along the same time as Jeremiah, which is a time where God called two prophets or pastors to tell the people, their congregations, their city, their community, that something was about to change. He gave them the unfortunate news that Babylon was preparing to come over and take them into captivity because they had not been a good example of God's people. They were both called to minister in these times of change. Now, no one likes to be taken over, but for the Jews, that was especially hard because this was the land that God promised them. This was also where the temple was, a place that they believed God physically dwelled. So how are they to worship God if they're going to leave their place? That's the story that goes on. And before we explain the imagery of the eagle and the plumage and the vine, because I'll get there, I promise. It's Father's Day, so I want to tell a story about my dad. I love my dad. He's a great man. He has been a driver for most of his life. When I was real little, he drove for Ozarka Trucks, and then he upgraded by every standards, and then he started driving for Häagen-Dazs ice cream. He worked for Häagen-Dazs for over 10 years and eventually became a manager of drivers. Pillsbury bought them out and restructured, so he said, you know what, I'm going to start my own business. And he moved us down to Corpus Christi, where he drove ice cream to convenience stores. So as a 10-year-old, I was still happy. Then, after a little while, he now works for a different company where he's an account manager, and he's not driving product around, but his area goes all the way from Waco down to McAllen. So needless to say, he's on the road quite a lot. And there's one thing that driving has taught is my dad profoundly has the spiritual practice of patience. Now, there's someone in our family who looks like him, is about 30 years younger, and does not have that same patience on the road. See, if we're driving on the road together and I see that wonderful detour sign, road work ahead, my father will sit there and go, this will be a good time to listen to the radio. He'll make some phone calls on his Bluetooth headphone. And he'll sit patiently and go through the detour, just knowing that's the way that it's supposed to be. I scout around looking for a way around it. Maybe I can go through this neighborhood and out this way and take the loop all the way around town, and then I'll bypass it. I'll do anything to avoid the bumper-to-bumper traffic, even if it means I need to go through skateboards in a community. I don't like going through detours. I try to find a way to avoid them. My father taught me a good example. He sits patiently and knows that it's only temporary. Israel, my friends, never planned to go to Babylon. They thought God gave them that land and they were there for good. But God said, you have to take a detour. God took the people of Israel and moved them into Babylon. And lots of neat things happen in Babylon. The whole book of Daniel occurs when that happens. But some people did not want to go. So whenever a detour presents itself, I can think of three options, and two of them are okay, and one of them's not. One is you could pretend like that's not going to happen and just run right through it. Israel could have seen Babylon coming and pretend like nothing was going to happen. That's what some of the false prophets did. You could, which is the right example, is just follow the road signs, sit through the detour, and know one day it'll end. Or you could do what some of the Israelites did in this story, which is look for someone else to save them. Now, if you read chapter 17, verse 12, it asks the question in the Bible, which is a good question to ask if you were like me after hearing it. It says, do you know what this symbolism means? Do you know what these eagles mean? And if you were like me, no, I don't. But luckily, God gives us the answer right afterwards. Sections 13 through, I think, 17 or 18. Some of the people in Israel, when faced with the fact they were going to have to go through a detour, rather than trusting that God was going to be a part of that detour, decided to go seek help from the neighboring nation of Egypt. They said, you know what? God doesn't want me to leave this land. He doesn't want me to take the detour. I'm supposed to stay on Interstate 35 the whole way. So I'm going to go have Egypt come and send me their armies and send me their ways to protect them. Scripture reads, but the king rebelled by sending his ambassadors in Egypt in order that they might send him his armies and horses. Those who sought help from Egypt was the vine that stretched not deep down to get more water, but stretched towards the other eagle. Now, church, this is not as simply a history lesson about what some prophet said to some people group a little bit while ago. I think the Bible has beautiful meaning for us today. That is, sometimes God is with us in the change. God was a part of Babylon taking over Israel. I'm not saying that God is always the cause or he was the reason that it happened, but you can find God in the comfortable and the uncomfortable. He is just not God of good feelings or good fortunes. He is God all of the time. And sometimes when we need change, we need to look for water by going to where the water is, not by hoping that another eagle will water us. Jeremiah was another prophet preacher speaking in those times, and you might know this verse. Behold, I have the plans for you to prosper and to do well. He was saying that as well. Jeremiah was a little bit not as picture-driven as Ezekiel. And he has this wonderful line in verse 7 in a later chapter that says, seek the prosperity of the city in which I'm sending you as exiles. Pray for it, for its behalf. For if it prospers, you prosper. Pray for the city I'm sending you to, because if it prospers, you prosper. Try praying that next time you're in traffic. But Clay, they were the enemy army. They were the ones taking him over. And God doesn't want you to pray for the people that are taking things from you. You know, you just had annual conference in Corpus, and I saw you eat shrimp. And there's that verse in the Old Testament about eating shrimp. So this is one of those like shrimp verses that we throw out, right? We don't pray for people that are doing bad to us to prosper, right? Well, Jesus says something very similar in his Sermon on the Mount. He says, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Pray for the people who just took my family, who took me away from my temple. You want me to pray that they do good? I can understand why some of the vines stretched out towards the other eagle. It just seemed like it was a little bit more of what they would want God to do. This is that passage that we know very well in Jeremiah. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper and not to harm you, to give you a future and a hope. This brings up my final point, and it's one that's a little bit of a common sense, but sometimes we need a good reminder. Detours are not permanent. Detours aren't permanent. Sometimes it feels that way when you're in the bumper-to-bumper traffic, but you will eventually get back to the heavenly four-lane road. God is the God who keeps his promises. Sometimes we feel like the detour isn't where it's supposed to be. I'll be honest, I'm not proclaiming that another Babylon's going to come and take us over or anything like that. But for a lot of us, perhaps we can relate to the feelings that Israel had of all of the changes going on. Maybe we feel it in a society level just like Israel was facing. Or maybe not being able to worship at the temple is just very personal to you. Maybe the temple in your life, the place that you knew where you can go to God, is no longer there. Maybe they've moved physically. Maybe they've moved on to life eternal. But God will eventually all bring us back together, as he did bring his children back to Israel. This sermon could probably be summed up in the verse that we just heard the Vacation Bible School people read. Right? When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Whenever you pass through the waters, church, God will be with you. Ezekiel used the eagles and vines. I tried to tell a story of my dad. I got one more story about application of this. Could you imagine if you were rolling down a river? It's not too hard because we got a river right here. And it's been smooth, and all of a sudden you have some rapids come. How silly would it be to jump out of your raft to go to the riverbank because all of a sudden it's not quite as smooth as it was before? That's what the plant did. It wasn't as smooth as it was before, so instead of entrusting that this was part of God's plan, they sought help from the other eagle, which was the nation of Egypt. But we don't have a God that throws us down the river without a raft. We don't have a God that leaves us alone when we go through the tough patches. We have a God that's with us, that keeps his promises. And if we stay there, he will eventually bring us back to the good four-lane road and away from the detour. For the God who keeps his promises, who is always with us, who loves us more than anything, church, guess what I have to say? Hallelujah, hallelujah, amen. I can't think. I was talking to Joni earlier. I said, she's great at picking out good hymns. I think hymns do better than sermons sometimes. Let's end our time together by singing God Will Take Care of You, hymn 130. Words will be on the screen. If you would like to join our church, we're going to sing that verse one last time, and if you would, you can come down. Take care of you. Good be day. Amen. Church, you may be seated. I have before us two wonderful sisters in Christ who have been attending here for 6 weeks and have loved your hospitality. I have Arlov Lund and Christina Brestel. I told them when I met them, I said, I'm new to this church. I'm only on first names right now. And then I was like, I have to go up here and say their last names. I should have remembered their last names. They come to us from other United Methodist churches, so I simply have one question to ask you, which is, will you, as a part of this congregation, participate with your prayers, presence, and gifts in this local church?
I will.
We will. Church, you guys also have something to say as well. Take a look at these lovely ladies. They asked that they have plans for this special weekend, so they're going to try and run out of here kind of quick. But I want you guys to give them great hugs next week as you welcome them as members of this congregation. You guys can go sit down. Before I offer ourselves a benediction as we go out, I have two announcements. One is for all men. You don't have to be a dad. You can be a puppy dad like me. We have a gift for you out in the foyer, as well as, wouldn't it be so much fun to take this down? I mean, it's going to be a blast. So we could definitely use some help afterwards to take this down. Let me offer us a word of prayer as we enter. Dear God, as we go out and cross the waters of life, if they get rapid, God, we know that we are with you. Give us the courage to stay in the boat and trust everything that you've already given us. Allow us to lean in you when times get hard. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Circle.